Hello and welcome to the CNBC TV 18 special on Wing Commander Abhinandan's return to India 2 days after he was captured by the Pakistan Army. Now, the Indian Air Force pilot has returned to India. He crossed over from the Wagah border at around 9:30 p.m. last night. On the diplomatic front, External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj attended the Council of Foreign Ministers of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. India had been invited to the event as a guest of honor. Addressing the Council's inaugural session, Sushma Swaraj stressed on the need to build pressure on the countries that support terror outfits. Without naming Pakistan, she urged the OIC to tell such states to dismantle terror infrastructure and stop providing funding to terror groups. Meanwhile, Pakistan's Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi has skipped the OIC event after the UAE refused to drop the invite to India. Addressing the joint session of the Pakistan Parliament, Qureshi said, and I quote, "I will not attend Council of Foreign Ministers as a matter of principle for them having an extended invitation as a guest of honor to Sushma Swaraj," end quote. Now, staying with the statements from Pakistan's foreign minister, in an interaction with CNN, Shah Mahmood Qureshi admitted that Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Masood Azhar, who has been accused of, by India of masterminding several terror attacks in the country, is in fact in Pakistan. However, Qureshi added that for Pakistani authorities to arrest Azhar, India would first have to hand over proof that is acceptable in Pakistani courts. As part of our comprehensive coverage, my colleague Shireen Bhan spoke to a host of experts to get their take on the expatriation. Listen in.
The Indian government saying that, look, let's keep this off public and the media. Let Wing Commander Abhinandan be repatriated and let's do this without the glare of cameras.
I would completely agree with that. But I would, you know, it would have been more appropriate if the Pakistani government had accepted, if there was such an offer, and accepted an offer from Indian government to fly him out directly, for the reasons that, you know, it's possible that after the ejection, Wing Commander Abhinandan would have suffered certain amount of injuries, particularly spinal and foot injuries, and therefore it's not correct to expose him to, you know, further stress by way of travel. And an airlift from there to Delhi would have been the best thing to do. Notwithstanding whatever the decisions that have been made, if he is coming across Wagah, then there is absolutely no need of a public spectacle. He's a serving officer, he's in uniform, and he must come across and ferried to Delhi. So I think this is the correct step to take. There is no need to make a public spectacle out of it.
Let me take that point across to Praveen Swamy. Praveen, the question that I was asking, do you believe that this is the right approach? The Indian government believes, let's not make this into a public spectacle, a media spectacle, and let's quash the narrative of this being an act of generosity on the part of Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan, because this is only the first step that is expected of Pakistan to deliver on the promises that it has made.
Absolutely. I think if you look at the slightly bigger picture here, this offered Pakistan a fortuitous, a lucky off-ramp, if you like, a way to get off this escalation highway, which instead set in after its attempts to hit at Indian air bases yesterday. Now, essentially, Pakistan thought that by raising the ante to by a massive level, by going for Indian military targets, it would succeed in establishing the robustness of its deterrence. It would signal to India that, look, even if you pursue terrorists across the border, we're willing to go to war, we're even willing to go close to the nuclear threshold. But what followed after that extremely irresponsible course of action was intense diplomatic activity behind the scenes. I think Pakistan was told quite bluntly by both the United States and by its allies in West Asia that it needed to get off this road.
Yeah.
And returning a prisoner of war, which normally happens at the end of a military crisis, was a signal from them that, you know, they're done with this particular chapter. The important thing, though, is that it still doesn't solve India's concerns. India didn't just strike at this terror training camp to kill terrorists. If anything, that was a peripheral objective. It was intended to make a point about India's deep anger at the way events were playing out. And I think India will be seeking guarantees from Prime Minister Imran Khan that the Jaish-e-Mohammed, the Lashkar-e-Taiba, other jihadist groups operating in Pakistan will be reined in. Now, what kinds of promises will be credible in India? After all, we've been here before. What kinds of promises will be credible remains to be seen, and that will be the stuff of diplomacy in coming days.
Yeah, you know, speaking of next steps now, and I want to talk a little bit about the CNN interview, Christian Amanpour interviewing the Pakistan Foreign Affairs Minister. And Praveen Swamy, I want you to comment on that, because we were just talking about Pakistan's inability previously to come good on the assurances that it's made with respect to the JEM. When being asked, is Masood Azhar in Pakistan, the Foreign Affairs Minister of Pakistan says Masood Azhar is in Pakistan, and to my knowledge, he's very unwell and is unwell to an extent that he cannot leave his house. On the question of arresting him, he says that India needs to give us evidence that is acceptable in the courts of Pakistan. After all, we will have to justify in the courts of Pakistan. So if they have unalienable evidence, share it with us. I mean, you know, you've got to take this with a little bit of a pinch of salt. There is not just evidence that India has provided, but the rest of the world has provided ample evidence against Masood Azhar.
You know, quite frankly, Shireen, I mean, these remarks are laughable. Forget India's voluminous evidence.
Yes.
Forget the evidence that led the United Nations Security Council to proscribe the Jaish. Forget what the Americans, what provoked the Americans to blacklist Masood Azhar. We can look at the words of Lieutenant General Javed Qazi, the former ISI chief in Pakistan's own Senate after 2002, where he stood up in the Senate and on the floor of the House said that the Jaish-e-Mohammed was responsible for the killings of innocent Kashmiris, was responsible for the killing of Daniel Pearl, the journalist, and was responsible for attacks within Pakistan on General Musharraf itself. Now, a minister of the Pakistan government, a former ISI chief, says this. I cannot understand what more evidence Pakistan wants.
You know, let's talk about the role that the U.S. is playing in all of this and the other actors as well, even though India maintaining that there is no third-party involvement.
Shireen, I think that we are seeing two things. One, an unprecedented international support for India. India's patience has been respected. India's right of counter-terror strikes has been recognized. I have, in my long diplomatic career, never seen such overwhelming international support. That is one. Two, India and U.S. relations have come a very long way. I mean, we all remember 1971 when President Nixon was threatening India with USS Enterprise. And fast forward to 2019, when Secretary of State issues a statement, Pompeo, to say that, to refer to India's counter-terrorism measures, refer to India-U.S. security partnership, defense partnership, to underline the fact that India and the U.S. are responsible for peace and security in the region. Very significant, Shireen. India and U.S. are responsible for peace and security. And then goes on to call on the Pakistani side to take action against the terror camps. So, and the frequency with which NSA John Bolton and our side have spoken, Secretary of State Pompeo and our side have spoken, I am, my own assessment is that there is a close coordination. Yes. And I won't be surprised, as I've said on your channel also earlier, if we find that eventually it's, we find that there was very close coordination when India carried out the counter-terror strikes against the camps. And not just the U.S., Shireen. In fact, I think that countries like Saudi Arabia, countries like UAE, and even China played a role here to quietly tell, privately tell Pakistan to see the writing on the wall.
And despite diplomacy prevailing, skirmishes were still being reported from the line of control. Shireen also spoke with VP Malik, retired Chief of Army Staff, as well as S. Krishnaswamy, retired Air Chief Marshal, to get their take on where India goes from here going forward.
General Malik and Air Marshal Krishnaswamy, let me come to you now. I understand that diplomatically, while the wheels are turning and with this development, there seems to be a degree of de-escalation in tensions. But, you know, ceasefire violations continue along the line of control, so the radars will continue to churn.
Yes, that's true. You know, we must remember our conflict with Pakistan today is on is counterterrorism, is against the terrorism which is being utilized from their land to harm us. And that is the primary objective, and that is the primary aim, which, as I think everybody agrees, has not been achieved by just one strike. So we have to be prepared for the long haul. The other thing, while generally I agree with all my panelists, I think there is a need to also not overplay the diplomatic card as well as the nuclear part. Now, the diplomatic card is absolutely essential, and I don't wish to undermine it. But last so many decades, we have seen, we have done our best, and it has not made any difference. We are slightly in a better position, and we hope that the international community will continue to support us. And yet, I feel that when it comes to a strike from our side, when it becomes necessary, because these people will continue to use their cheapest weapon that they have got in terms of terrorist activity, so this will continue, and therefore I do not wish to undermine the military part, which you have just now mentioned. And that is exactly what was indicated by our three soldiers who gave the briefing. As far as the nuclear aspect is concerned, again, I think, yes, they have the nuclear weapons, but let's not overplay that. I don't believe that as soon as we cross the line of control, unless we go and do a heavy damage in their country, I don't believe that they will be able to use it. In any case, they all know that if they try to use it, or if they do use it, they will get a very heavy dose from us. So I have always believed that there is certain space. That is the space in which we have utilized our airstrike against their terrorist camp. And we have also showed our result. And that is what I was saying, that the political authorities is now prepared to take slightly greater risk than it had taken in the past. So let's not overplay this nuclear bit and all.
There is also the fear that politicians from all sides will try and use this to ratchet up their domestic constituencies as well. This is an election year. What would you advise, sir, going forward?
Look, I think even while we welcome and we are very happy that Wing Commander Abhinandan has come back to us, there is no need for us to go into euphoria. It's part of the fight which is continuing against terrorism. Once again, I emphasize. And there is absolutely no need to go into jingoism. Also, I would suggest that we should not politicize the national security issue, in this case, a more sensitive issue, because the conflict is still on, as I believe. As you said yourself, the firing is continuing along the line of control even today. So my appeal to all the political parties, in fact, to the rest of India, would be that let's not politicize whatever activity, military activity or diplomatic activity which is going on, and let us put across a very united front as a nation. And that can only be done if the political parties come to this agreement that national security is far more important and well ahead of politics, notwithstanding the coming elections.
Absolutely. Chief Marshal Krishnaswamy, your comments on that, sir.
I want to say something slightly different, otherwise it gets very boring. You are, after all, it's a business channel.
Go ahead.
The interesting part is the Pakistani army runs the greatest business of Pakistan. I think you should explore a bit on that. They don't want to let go of power, not because they want to kill, want to shoot Indians. They want to stay in power because of money. Mm. They have their hand on every pie.
Yeah.
Right from what you call real estate to businesses and you name it all, they don't pay any income tax. They get a chunk of land, houses or whatever it is whenever they want, and they have a fleet of cars, they run buses, I think they even run airlines, what all. I think we need to now hit at their military business, really. you know, we need to explore what are they up to? What are they hanging on in power for? After all, they pretend to be a democracy. Mm. They are not. Why are they hanging on to power? Is money. Everywhere it's about money. Okay. Mm. So as long as they're there, they'll keep hitting us. That's their interest. And they will always find some bogey to hit, bash India, because that'll keep their business going. And they want to keep busy hitting Kashmir, because in Kashmir, that's another business. We'll have to look at that. I suggest you, as a business channel, I think you should open explore what kind of a business their Pakistani army is doing. And it should come out, really. I think we should just publicize it, you know, the balance sheet or whatever it is, and we will compare that to Ambani's here or whichever company that you want to, how great a business the Pakistani army is doing. Leave the guns out of this, you know? That will make it more interesting,
Leave the guns out of it. Bring out the... I completely agree with you. Let's bring out the balance sheet of the Pakistan army. And I think that's a great idea that you bring to the table, because really, at the end of the day, as we made very clear, that it's not going to be a decision that Imran Khan will take. General Bajwa and the army headquarters will have to sign off on the engagement that they want to take forward.
And on that note, we'll slip into a short break. Coming up on the other side, we'll continue our special coverage of the return of Wing Commander Abhinandan. Stay tuned for that.